Welcome to All About Hopkinton, the original program highlighting the people and organizations that make Hopkinton a great place to live. I'm Mary Arnott, your host. Today we have with us Hopkinton resident and HCAM volunteer John Ritz. John, welcome so much to the show.
Oh, thank you for having me, Mary.
Well, I was looking forward to this because you and I have worked as HCAM volunteers for over 10 years now.
Oh, my goodness. I couldn't believe it was 10 years when you told me.
Yeah, it's gone fast, but I hope we have another 10.
Oh, yes.
And we'll talk more about HCAM during the show.
Absolutely.
But before we get to that part, why don't you start a little bit with your background, where are you from, education, whatever you'd like to share with us.
Sure. I was born in Pennsylvania. We moved around a bit. Lived in New Jersey. I lived in Mansfield, Massachusetts before my family finally settled in just outside of Albany, a little town called Delmar. And that's where I spent most of my time growing up. Left there, came to Boston for college like millions of other kids. Returned to the Albany area for my graduate school and then came back to Boston for my first job. I worked for a cardiologist at the Harvard School of Public Health. That job lasted about a year and a half, and I moved on to another company called Meditech, which is a medical software company, electronic health records. And I've never left there. I've been there for 32 years now. Met my wife, Jane, there, who you know and have met.
I know Jane, yes.
And we got married, moved into a place in Holliston, Massachusetts, first. We're there for about 4 years, and then moved to Hopkinton in the early 90s when our son Andy was born, and Andy's another HCAM person.
So. Yes, Andy does a lot of good volunteer work for HCAM as well.
So that's how I got to Hopkinton.
Now, I know you want to share with us a little bit about the background that you have that got you to Meditech and what you studied, because you have both a bachelor's and a master's degree, I understand.
Yeah, well, my degrees are in biomedical engineering, which is probably why I'm sitting in HCAM after all these years. It's the engineering and technical background and that nerd factor that finally got me here.
Mm-hmm. Now, does that kind of help with, because I know as a very young person you got interested in music, and they always say people who have engineering and math backgrounds always seem to have a real good talent at music also, that you play instruments. And you want to tell us a little bit about how you got started at an early age in your music?
Sure. Well, it pretty much like every kid in Hopkinton, fifth grade, they put out a whole bunch of instruments and said, you're in the band, pick an instrument. And I got handed a baritone horn, which nobody has ever heard of, including me at the time. But somehow or another, it stuck with me, and I've played ever since then. I played all the way through high school, played through college, and then beyond. My main instruments are euphonium, which looks like a small tuba, and for any players out there, you progress from baritone horn to euphonium, and I also play a full-size tuba, which is fun.
I have to admit, I didn't know what a euphonium was.
No.
Did I say it right, euphonium?
Yep, very few people.
Yeah, until you said that in some information you gave me with like a little tuba. I said, oh, okay.
Years ago, there was the Hopkinton schools brought a brass quintet here, and they had a euphonium player, and he cut up to explain what a euphonium is, and his joke was that it's Latin for there's no way you can find a job with this instrument.
Oh.
So. It's a good instrument. I also collect instruments. I have a whole basement full of odds and ends instruments of all shapes and sizes. Usually I find them at garage sales and such.
Mm-hmm.
I joke that I can get Twinkle Twinkle Little Star out of absolutely anything. I actually did that once when my son was in preschool. I loaded up all my instruments into the car, took him into his school, and played Twinkle Twinkle Little Star on each one of them for the kids there. And sometime after that, the father of one of the kids, a little girl, approached me. We were at some school function. He said his daughter came home from school that day and told him he had to buy her a saxophone.
She fell in love with the saxophone.
So it was fun. But yeah, a little bit of every instrument in there.
I bet it was very entertaining for the students to see you do across that whole spectrum of your collection there.
It was, though the teachers in the infant room complained that we were waking the little babies, so that was the downside. But no, it's a lot of fun. And I bring them all out every once in a while and go through them and make sure I can still play them all.
Well, I'm glad you stuck with your music. I didn't. I started in fourth grade or fifth grade and back when I was in school then too, and fell in love with the violin, but unfortunately I didn't have the determination to stick with it. I can still read notes.
Okay.
And I can still make it sound like a cat screeching. So, but I didn't stick with it like you did.
I'll have to bring in my old violin for you sometime.
Oh, I don't know. Now, with this collection you have, do you have to maintain them? I mean, I imagine there's something you have to do to...
There's some, but mostly it's a matter of playing them on a regular basis, keeping the brass instruments oiled up, keeping the stringed instruments in tune. Things like saxophones and clarinets, the reeds have to be replaced from time to time, but mostly they just look good. I mostly like the instruments that have something of a past to them. I just bought an antique piccolo at an auction. Mostly because it was almost 120 years old and it used to belong to a railroad.
Does it still work?
Oh, yes. You can,
oh, wow.
Yeah,
okay.
Old wooden.
So it's not just for show. You could actually play on it if you wanted to.
I can get most of a scale out of it so far. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. But it had a neat history and a past and a story behind it. So I picked out for that. And any instrument that I buy, I'll do the research. I'll find out when it was made, where it was made. My two main instruments, my euphonium and my tuba, I got through the Salvation Army. My mother used to be a daycare, used to run a daycare center for the Salvation Army in Albany. And these two old instruments were in a cabinet covered in tarnish. And she said, "My son plays. Anybody care about these?" And they said, "No, take them home." So I acquired them then. But they both have USN, US Navy, embossed on the bells. So at some point, and they're both from about the 1920s. Hmm. So at some point, those went through the Navy, and I would love to find out where they went. Did they just stay in a Navy band on stateside? Did they go to the Pacific where my father was during World War II? Who knows? Well,
a mystery you might have to investigate.
Absolutely.
Now, do you have do you have a room in your home where you display all of these, or?
Yeah, the basement is pretty much
the
all
basement
of,
is
they're
yours,
all lined up down there, but they're sort of spread throughout the house. We have a piano in one room, and
there's a little history behind that piano too, as I understand.
The piano belonged to my mother. She was a piano teacher and also a cello player, and the family story is that she bought it for $50 and used it to teach her students. And for me, the cool thing is that my family moved on average until we got to Albany about every 3 or 4 years. So I think I figured out there were about 9 times my family moved, and that grand piano moved every single one of those times, which just surprises
me. That's no small feat.
But it was made in Boston. It was made at the Chickering Piano Factory in the South End. And I recently just had it restored, so all new strings, it plays like a dream again. So.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, it's cool.
Well, you have a lot of ways that you've used this musical background of yours to do things in Hopkinton and around the area with concerts and things. Would you like to talk about that a little
bit? Well, the Hopkinton connection with the music is my son started playing saxophone in school, and so I started looking for a summer band for him to play, to keep playing, because I knew it's easy to lose interest. So we looked around. Hopkinton didn't have one, and we joined the Ashland Summer Band. Had a great time playing together, and afterwards, the next fall, I approached Steve Yavaro, who is the head of the music department here, and said, "Can we have a summer band in Hopkinton?" And as luck would have it, that was something he was interested in. He was looking for some way to keep all of the students playing all summer. So really, from just that simple question, this summer band arose, and it's last year was our 12th year playing. We have 13 coming up this summer. It's become a tradition in town. We play on the town common as part of the concerts on the common every summer. It's an amazing time. It's about 50 players. I'm going to say about 2/3 students, but 1/3 of adults. People that in most cases haven't touched an instrument in years are scared to death of playing, and they pick them up, and within minutes there, you can see the joy back in their faces that they remember how to play. And it's a lot of fun. It's also just a unique, one of the few places where adults and kids can work as peers. Typically, we drive our kids to an event and watch them play a game or play in a concert. And if we as adults do something, our kids stay at home. But in this band, we're all just musicians. Mm-hmm. So my son and I, we still play in the band every year. And you know, we'll talk about, what'd you think of that piece? I had problems here. You sounded great on that. And we're no longer father and son. It's less now that we're both adults, but mm-hmm. way back when it was in eighth grade, it just introduced a whole new dynamic to the relationship that was just absolutely wonderful, and we love it.
Still. And the band does a really fine job, too. I mean, it's just a wonderful concert. And you're right, it's a tradition now.
It is.
Everybody looks forward to it.
And it stretches the students. You know, with HCAM, I filmed the school concerts each year, and a typical, even the high school, they'll have maybe three or four pieces that they play, and they will have been practicing for about 3 months. Summer band, we have a six-week rehearsal period, and we play 10 or 12 pieces. So these kids are really getting pushed. They're learning new music. They're playing more than they ever have, and they're learning from the adults. So it's a lot of fun.
Well, I don't know how you find time to do all this with music because you're so busy with everything else that you do as well. But do you still go back and ever see anybody that you played with in college in the bands or anything?
Oh, there? Sometimes I play with the BU alumni band and the alumni pep band. We just did a hockey game a little while ago. And I keep in touch with a lot of those friends through the usual Facebook and such. But yeah, it's fun to go back. I have friends at work that we used to play. We used to have a brass group at my company that I organized that we play at the annual holiday party. I've been in community bands. I play at, here's a silly one, Tuba Christmas every year.
Tuba
which
Christmas,
is
huh?
Exactly what it sounds like. It's tubas playing Christmas tunes.
All tubas, no other instruments?
It's tubas, euphoniums, everything in the tuba family.
In the family, okay.
And the really short story is that it was first put on to honor a tuba teacher and player named William Bell, who was born on Christmas Day. And one of his students decided to honor him and said, I'll arrange some tunes for tubas and invite people to come and play. And he put out the notice, and 300 tuba players showed up in New York City for the very first one. That was almost 50 mm-hmm. years ago. So I play at the Boston Tuba Christmas, which gets about 150 tuba players out of Faneuil Hall, and the Freeport, Maine Tuba Christmas, which gets about 50. And we play right at L.L. Bean. So, yeah.
That's amazing. I think it's your music background that kind of got you first started with HCAM, wasn't it? That you wanted to film something?
Well, there's actually a couple of connections. I had joined a community band based in Medway because I had seen them playing on HCAM at St. John's. They do a holiday concert there every year. Mm-hmm. They've been doing that for almost 20 years now. And just happened to see them playing on HCAM, so I was looking for a band to join. Joined up with them, and I started using the HCAM bulletin board to post notices of their concerts to help promote the band. And that's, you know, so of course if you put a notice up, you have to watch HCAM to see your notice up being displayed. I thought that was cool. So then when I was in the band and we were playing at St. John's, I approached HCAM and said, hey, we're having a concert. Could you send somebody to film it? And they said, well, how about we just give you a camera and you can take care of it? So I checked out a camera, and that was my start with HCAM. Mm-hmm. Before that, I had contacted HCAM for the summer band to come and record that. And again, it was fun making this little suggestion, all of a sudden seeing people show up with cameras and starting to record. Mm-hmm. So, and I've been with HCAM, like you say, 10 years now.
Yeah, not long after that. I remember you and I both went through the workshop together.
See,
that's where we met.
There we go.
Jim Cousins ran one of those 6-week workshops teaching us everything about the cameras, the station, the editing and everything.
And look at where we are now.
Look where we stars, huh?
I think both of us have done just about everything here. I know I've done.
You're a little more active with it than I am, I think. I have to tilt my hat to you. You do a little bit more than
we've both produced, directed. I've done a little bit of editing. I haven't done as much on-camera work as you have, though I've done a little bit of that. I even do that with the Trails Club. I've filmed a few things for the Trails Club, and it's just nice to use HCAM to push that sort of stuff out to the community and show, mm-hmm. basically share the things that I love about Hopkinton with the rest of the town through HCAM. So.
Well, that's a good lead into the Trails Club. I wasn't going to quite talk about that yet, but that's all right. We can do that. We can always come back to HCAM if we want to.
Whichever way.
Yeah. So tell us about the Trails Club.
Oh, the Trails
Club. And your involvement.
I've been always done stuff outdoors, and I think it's just the ages we all lived in, the family of five. It's a good way to keep the kids active is throw them out the door. So my brothers and I always did hiking. I did Boy Scouts growing up, and a lot of camping. Then after college, I took up more backpacking, did a lot of that. So when we moved to Hopkinton, I started looking at the trails around here and tried to figure out where there were places to go. And I saw this notice one day about a trails club being formed and having a hike over at College Rock. So I went to that, and it turned out to be a cool group of people, and I've stayed with that ever since. That was in 2005, was that first hike. I made the great mistake at one meeting saying we should have a website, and so now I'm the webmaster for the Trails Club. I make maps for them, I lead hikes, I'm sort of their social media person too. It's a cool organization. We aren't connected with the town, though some people think we are. It got its start because there was a resident who had some interest in promoting more trails in town, and she went to the town looking for the committee or whoever was in charge of trails and found that there is no such entity in town. So she said, I'm going to just get a club together. And the Trails Club is an advocacy club that we go out and show people where the trails are, lead them on hikes. We'll work with the town or suggest to the town, hey, this developer is coming in. Can we get some of their land to have some trails? Can we find more routes for trails through town and connect the existing trails? But our primary goal is to get people out on the trails that we have. There are almost at least 20 named trail systems in town and tons more unofficial trails, and people don't know that they're there. So once a month we lead a hike. We have one coming up this month now, and it's just a matter of getting people and saying, this trail is right in your backyard, and here it is. And we get comments from people saying, geez, I drive by this every day. I've always wondered where that trail went, or I never knew this trail was here. This is cool.
I didn't know there were so many. And you said at least 20 named ones, and then the ones that aren't named.
Yep.
And I think the group's done some things with maintaining and signage. And
yep, we
you
go
know,
out.
So when you go walking, you know where to go. And
that's it. We've recently restored the Berry Acres trails, which are right across the street from Ice House Pond and the Golden mm-hmm. Pond Health Facility. The Center Trail, which has become enormously popular, was all the Trails Club's doing. We've actually built that twice now and cleared that out. I remember walking it when it first came up, and it was just a tiny path and all overgrown, and now it's a beautiful trail that people love. But we'll work with various agencies. We work with the state parks in town at mm-hmm. Lake Whitehall and over at Hopkinton State Park to keep some of their trails clear. Anything we can do to just keep people involved with the trails. If someone comes out and spends a day clearing brush off a trail, they have an interest in maintaining that trail, keep making sure it's protected and more trails come. And trails are just nice to have. It's a good way of, there's so much open space in town. and the trails are the way to get into them and see them. So if we can build these trails and let people get to this great resource we have in town, it's a nice thing.
And unless the weather is completely nasty, I mean, you can go out walking and hiking them, you know, 365 days a year.
Oh, absolutely. And we make a point of saying we are multi-user trail organization. Our logo has obviously a hiker, but a biker and a skier and a horseback rider. We aren't just about keeping it for the walkers. We want everybody to enjoy them for whatever they can be used for.
And there's some that go a very long way and connect into other towns, don't
yep.
they, as I remember?
The more we can do, the ideal would be to have some way to walk from one end of the town to the other. There's obviously 495 is going to cut some of them up in half, but people just don't know what we have out here. I have 250 acres of open space right behind my house, and I'm out there walking all the time, and I almost never see anybody out there, so they're fun. Mm-hmm.
Well, once they watch this show, they'll know more about it.
There we go.
And they can check things out. We'll provide some websites and things
that
they can go
to. Yeah, I was going to say, look at the HCAM website. It's an amazing, if I say so myself, resource. We've got maps. We've got links.
You mean the trail website.
The Trails Club. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Maps, trail maps, links to other organizations around. So. And we have an email list with about 200 people on it now, so a lot of resources there.
But you did mention HCAM again, and I just want to say,
Part of my life.
The viewers know that you're so involved with so many different programs there. I mean, Physicians Focus, I know you've worked on, and all the school sports,
Yep, I'm co-producer on the school sports. I do the concerts on the Common. We've done, I think, about 10 years of those now. Bringing those up. All of the school activities, the proms and the plays and who knows what. Even town meeting, I'm starting to like going. I look forward to going to town meeting for the HCAM coverage now. So.
Well, you've done things at the Cultural Arts Center, too. I know you've taken cameras over there.
Get their productions. When they used to come here, I don't know if anybody remembers Hopkinton Idol, but... That was fun here. Mm-hmm. It's a long way since when I first came to town. One of the big things for me was having cable television. We didn't have it in Holliston. So when I got to Hopkinton, I remember, cable TV, this is cool. I looked around and I found it was called Hop TV back then.
Mm-hmm. I remember, yeah.
And I turned it on and there were these kids jumping on a trampoline pretending to be wrestlers. And I said, this is really weird, but it's fun, and it sort of hooked me in. And back then, it was that show, probably just a handful of other shows, and then really the bulletin board going most of the day. And you look at what's on now, and
it's come such a long
way. It's all homegrown programming pretty much all day, so it's a...
Yeah, we have to applaud the crew here.
Oh, absolutely.
And the volunteers.
And Jim Cousins has done a really nice job of guiding this station, in just that short amount of time, 10, 12 years, to bring it from what it was to where it is now.
And just for full disclosure, you and I both sit on the board of directors
now
for HCAM. And
a little bit,
hope to continue to see it grow. And
absolutely.
We're in HD and all sorts of things have changed. But not to take away from you, though.
The best is yet to come.
You are just so involved in so many things. I don't know how you find the time. I guess they say... if you want something done, give it to a busy person because they just seem to manage their time and organize and able to accomplish all of this. So, but we're almost out of time. Is there anything we haven't touched on?
I'll just point out that there's a thread going through all of this stuff. From all of the things I've mentioned, the music, summer band, HCAM, trails, it's all related to me liking to share the things that I find enjoyable. The summer band, I love looking around and the fact that we have this way for other people to join in and enjoy the music the way I do. Get out on the trails and see these beautiful areas that I know about. And HCAM broadcasting concerts and such for everybody. So that's sort of the thread that runs through all of these, and I hope we can continue doing it.
Yep. I think you will. I mean, you're out there in the forefront, but you're also behind the scenes doing so much to support all of that.
Keep pushing
at
it.
HCAM and the Trails Club, and yes, and thank you for all of that.
Well, thank you.
I'm glad you could be on the show today.
I appreciate it.
If you'd like to find more information about the Hopkinton Trails Club and HCAM, visit their websites located on the screen below. For everyone here at HCAM, I'm Mary Arnott, and thank you for watching this episode of All About Hopkinton.
This show often talks to people who have interesting hobbies or careers or different things that they have going on that affect our community.
I'm Mary Arnott, your host.
There is a huge need for providing food for individuals and family.
And that's the key, it's working well together.
You can see more episodes online at our website, hcam.tv.
Hi, I'm Tim Kilduff, and this is Business Matters.
I think we got to talk a little bit about the history.
I mean, you were born into something pretty special, weren't you?
Yeah.
The shop is a safe haven for a lot of people, young and old.
Business Matters is HCAM's show focusing not only on businesses in Hopkinton, but more importantly, the people who run and manage those businesses.
Welcome to Hopkinton Coffee Break.
A very special dessert done by a woman from Hopkinton that I've started using regularly.
We had your residents participating both as vendors and as shoppers. Yeah. And
that was so much fun.
Real Hopkinton Housewives, if you're on Facebook, you will have a blast. Thanks for joining
us. Cheers, guys.
Us.
Thank you.
Yeah, good to see you too.
See you guys.
Bye.